sure of. Whatever happens the next 20 minutes, just go with it.
Go with it. Go,
like
Mr. Stark?
Hey.
Hello. How do you have a 9:30 dinner?
Perfect. I'll be there at 11. Is this us?
Absolutely. It can be.
Great. Make it us.
Okay.
Mr. Musk. How are you?
Congratulations on the promotion.
Thank you very much.
Those Merlin engines are fantastic.
Good idea for an electric jet.
You do. Yeah. Then we'll make it work.
My heart is pounding, my stomach's inside out. I'm feeling kind of shaky, my mind is full of doubt. Think about is fear itself. I wish I could. I screw my head and put it on the shelf. You know we're going out. Strange. Everything is twisted. Everything is oh so tight. Don't know what I'm looking at. The lights are all too bright. My brain's about to crumble, spill out on the floor. Sweep them up, throw them away. I don't want them anymore. You know what I'm doing.
I want to talk about the sun, the color of the sun.
Okay. Right? All right. Well.
And so here's the thing. If you're a school child and you to draw a scene and you want to put the sun in the sky, what crayon do you reach for?
It's always a big yellow ball.
It's always yellow. And this notion has been with us since childhood, that the sun is yellow. And that's not true. It's not even close to being true.
And
we know the sun isn't red. Of course, it's not red. We know that's an optical effect.
No, this isn't Krypton.
It's not Krypton, exactly.
Come on,
with a red,
guys.
We had a red sun. So you know intuitively it's not red, but somehow you don't know intuitively that it's also not yellow. Okay? What color is the sun? It is white.
Now,
white.
Come on, man.
Is so tight. Staring out the window, everything is just too bright. My brain's about to crumble, spill out on the floor. I wish I could screw my head and kick it out the door. You know what I'm doing. Stay.
Ready now. Enterprise, this is Captain Kirk. Beam us aboard.
Captain Kirk never said, beam me up, Scotty. Do you know that people all over the world in every language who watch Star Trek have said, beam me up, Scotty?
I know. Never said it.
Scotty, beam me up. Two to beam up. I mean, everything else but beam me up, Scotty. Nobody ever said, beam me up, Scotty. He's never actually said, beam me up, Scotty. Unbelievable.
Well, George, it's been fascinating. Thank you so much for joining me. I'm going this way. Are you coming?
I have my own transportation.
Okay, bye.
Beam me up, Scotty.
Down immediately.
Shall I have snotty beanie down, sir?
Oh, by that beanie stuff. Is it safe?
Oh, yes, sir. Snotty beamed me twice last night. It was wonderful.
All right, I'll take a shot at it. What the hell, it works on Star Trek.
Snotty. Beam him down.
Yes, sir. Immediately, sir.
Captain's log, stardate 5373.4. We are in orbit around the planet of the time vortex, the focus of all the timelines of our galaxy. Our mission is to assist a team of historians in the investigation of Federation history.
The travelers are returning.
Cease review.
What a trip, Bones. Orion at the dawn of its civilization. Even just observing, not touching anything for fear of changing some piece of history. What's the matter? Bones? Who's he, Jim? What do you mean, who's he? You know Mr. Spock.
Right, I don't, Jim.
Kirk to Enterprise.
Enterprise.
Beam up.
Aye, sir.
I was expecting it to be one of the historians with you. But a Vulcan?
Explain yourself, Mr. Scott.
Sir?
I don't know what's going on, but the first officer of this ship will be treated with respect.
Captain, I assure you no one has ever treated me otherwise.
Who are you?
Well, I thought sure you'd know Thalen by now, Jim. He's been your first officer for 5 years.
Captain, I have come to the conclusion that this is not a game.
No. But if it's reality, what happened?
Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Heisenberg says that, in quantum mechanics, the more precisely the position is determined, the less precisely the momentum is known in this instant, and vice versa. Explanation is the many-worlds theory. Let's say you're standing on top of a cliff. You're making the decision on whether or not to jump. According to the many-worlds theory, the very moment that your decision is made, the universe splits into two, one copy being the timeline in which you jump off the cliff, the other being the one where you walk away. Of course, the you that jumped off the cliff doesn't know that the universe split into two, and in your reality, life just continues on as normal, while simultaneously in a different universe, a copy of you continues his life following his decision not to jump from the cliff. The many worlds theory says that every single time a decision is made by anyone or anything, the universe splits, and yourself inhabits only one of nearly infinite different universes. Now to quantum suicide. In this thought experiment, you, the experimenter, are standing in a box with a nuclear bomb that, if exploded, will immediately and unconditionally kill you. Hooked up to the bomb is a trigger that measures the spin value of a proton every 3 seconds. If the proton spins one way, there's just a click sound. The other way, the bomb explodes. We can now conclude beyond a reasonable doubt that you are immortal. What happened is that every time the proton was measured, every time the bomb could have gone off, the universe split into two, one being the scenario in which you die, the other being the one in which you live. But why didn't you go to the universe where the bomb went off? Why didn't you go to the one where you died? Well, it's quite simple. The version of you who died cannot know that he died. Only the version of you who lived can know that you lived. But the next time the bomb went off, the same situation occurred. Only the living version of you continues on in consciousness. On and on this will continue, forever, because the version of you who lives can continue to realize he's living. You can't die because only your living self will keep consciousness in existence. This, of course, brings up a lot of existential questions. Will the version of yourself who lives be the same person? Are the people around you in the new universe the same people? Shouldn't everyone be immortal from any sort of death in some universe? What does it mean to be a person if there are so many versions of you? There are certainly flaws to this theory, and there are certainly unanswerable questions.
We're going to need a bigger boat, which has become part of the language for people who are faced with an insurmountable problem.
Now, my head is spinning.
Hey, we've got a problem here.
What did you do?
Nothing. I stirred the tanks.
Whoa!
This is Houston. Say again, please.
Houston, we have a problem.
The interpretation of that double slit, that, you know, the double slit experiment, where a photon appears to go through two slits at once. I mean, there are 13 possible interpretations of quantum theory. And one of them is what we call the many worlds. So we explain the fact that the photons appear to mingle with each other by saying that the photon goes through one of the slits and it mingles with another photon that went through the other slit in a parallel reality. And that's one possible explanation, and actually it's embraced by a sizable minority of physicists, you know.
Yes, it is.
50 years after it was suggested. We face two possibilities. Either these parallel universes exist, or the universe behaves as if they exist. And I think most physicists would say, you know, the universe behaves as if they exist. But, you know, I don't know which one you'd like to pick, you know.
Captain's log, supplemental. When we were in the time vortex, something appears to have changed the present as we know it. No one aboard recognizes Mr. Spock. The only answer is that the past was somehow altered.
Okay, guys, this is it. I've rounded up a few super fans for something special. They think they're here to read some classic Star Wars lines for a video celebrating the 40th anniversary. But what they don't know is that I'll be their surprise co-star.
All right, we're gonna do the scene where you actually say, I am your father.
Luke, I am your father.
One more time, because remember, this is like a moment that completely blindsides him. Never expected. He has no idea. Didn't see this coming. So I really, really need you to sell it for me, okay?
Luke, I am your father.
No, that's impossible. You can't be Dad Vader.
How are you, man?
He told me you killed.
No, I am your father.
Now, though there is no definitive answer to this question, people have started coming up with theories and examples and explanations of why this effect is happening. The most interesting of them being ones about alternate realities and universes. Yes, you heard me right. Alternate realities and universes. Now, many people do not believe in these topics, but there's no definitive answer or evidence to prove it incorrect, just as there is no evidence to prove it correct. Now, on top of this, people have also started blaming their own memory. They've started saying, I can't remember things correctly, or I have a horrible memory. With this kind of mentality, how can the human race continue to be confident? if we have to be confident and positive to survive, what will this negativity do to us? Now, you may be wondering, why is this important? Who cares if people forget how to spell the cereal brand name of a cereal company? But it's more than just that. This effect opens up multiple questions for the psychology community. How does our memory change? Or is everything around us changing and we just don't notice it? The Mandela effect opens up multiple opportunities and questions for the human race, us, to explore, question, answer, and study. So as I leave you all, I ask you to pay close attention to things around you. Pay even closer attention to things that are close and dear to your heart. Because who knows? One day, they may not be how you remember them now. Thank you.
Mr. DeBruzzo, I'm Ed McMahon, and we're signing up people for...
Yes, I am.
Miss Murphy, Ed McMahon. We're starting up... No.
Dreams really do come true.
Ed McMahon, see.
Ed McMahon.
Yes, Ed McMahon. We're having our first ever... Yes. Tuesday night at the high school. We're starting up the Neighborhood Watch in this area, and here's all the information.
Stevie! Down here, please.
No tango, Danelle. Neighborhood Watch. We're having this Neighborhood Watch, the first one.
Right.
I'll come back.
Bye-bye.
I have to apologize. I thought this was the Joe Franklin studio. I'll tell you why I'm here. I happen to be in town over doing some stuff for the NBC affiliate.
That's right.
And, you know, Ed McMahon, our good friend, could not be here. Yeah. But it seems, David, that you are the $1 million winner.
Oh, my God!
The odds are astronomical.
Yeah. Well, geez, screw GE then, huh?
Isn't that nice? Ed would have been here, but he's in Hawaii with something.